Hi everybody, and welcome back to Lecture 2, The Manufacturing Process. We'll now go to our fourth and last section, in which I will discuss several manufacturing issues. So the first issues that we're going to discuss are hillocking and electromigration. So hillocking is actually when these types of little hills or hillocks are created in a conductor. So we have this in this picture, we have an aluminum film, and there's stress on the aluminum that can cause these little bumps to happen, or it can cause depressions in it, which we would call a void. As you can see here in this photograph, a void can be so deep that it can actually break through most of the metal or all of the metal. If it breaks through the whole thing, it causes an open circuit. If it just breaks through part of it, it just changes the resistance, and the resistance becomes higher through the conductor. Same thing with the hillock. If the hillock gets too big and it cracks through the interlayer dielectric, what we're going to have here is a short circuit between two separate nets. So this is a really bad phenomenon. It shouldn't happen. And one of the ways to prevent it is by adding copper atoms into the aluminum field. It makes it stronger against it. Okay. The other phenomenon, which is very similar, is called electromigration. Electromigration is basically the movement of electrons inside a conductor. So we have a current going through the conductor. That's many, many of these electrons. There's some sort of flux of electrons that are running through this conductor. And they're always banging on the aluminum or the whatever the conductive material. They're banging on the atoms. And it's similar to if we took a ball and we started throwing it at the wall, nothing's going to happen. It's just going to bounce back. But if we throw lots and lots of these balls for a long time, eventually the wall will crack or break or change. And this is the same thing that happens here. Eventually we're going to get displacement of the aluminum atoms, and you can see here that there's a break in the conductor, which causes a change in its resistance. It can even cause a real crack and a short circuit, or it can cause a hillock that will actually a crack which will cause an open circuit, or it can cause like a hillock that can connect it to an adjacent net. Okay, so the problem here is a reliability problem. This happens when we operate the circuit over a long period of time, which means we actually have a lot of this current going through our conductors all the time. And the current's going through so much that these electrons are banging on the atoms, banging on the atoms, banging on the atoms. Eventually, they're going to move them and cause these reliability problems. So the way to actually avoid this, there are several ways, but we have some sort of a design rule that is that we have to keep the current density under a certain limit. So J, the current density, which is amperes by centimeter square of the face of our inductor, has to be under a certain limit, which will be defined by our manufacturer. And it depends a lot on the material, and again, aluminum is very sensitive to this type of electromigration. One of the ways to stay away from it is, again, putting copper inside, or actually replacing the entire aluminum with copper interconnect. And eventually that was done, and copper has a much higher threshold of current density that we're allowed to use. But electromigration, or we call it EM, and that relates to both hillocking and electromigration. It's probably the biggest reliability problem in semiconductors, and we have to really be careful and check it all the time. Another thing I want to point out is that most of the current in CMOS circuits is running to and from the power rails. So if this is our CMOS inverter, what we're actually doing is we're charging up our output capacitance through VDD, right? And we're discharging our capacitance through ground. After that, we have another one of these inverters, which again is seeing some sort of capacitance. So we don't have as much current going through the signals. The current density through the signals is much, much, much smaller than the current density that's running through these power rails, the ground and VDD, which is going to all these different inverters that are connected along the way. So traditionally, we would only actually check electromigration on the power rails. So electromigration was always run on power rails. Nowadays, because the conductors are so small, that we also check what's called signal EM, which is checking the electromigration, the current density over a signal wire does not pass a threshold as well. Okay, the next manufacturing effect that I want to discuss is the antenna effect. So the antenna effect is the problem is the charge is built up on interconnect layers during deposition. So when we lay down this metal layer, charge gets built up inside, similar to like static electricity when we walk on a carpet with sneakers or something like that. Okay, and if enough charge is created, it can cause a high voltage breakdown to break down the thin gates. So let's look at the two examples over here. So here we have the gate of a transistor, okay, and here we have a diffusion somewhere, and what happens is we first make metal one, okay, so we create this contact, we create this metal, we create this contact and this metal, and there's a very small amount of charge that's built up inside this guy. So then we create metal two, so we create the contact and this metal, we create the contact and metal, again, there's a small amount of charge. Finally, we create metal three, and there's much more charge that's built up here, but it's not that much charge. Okay, because this is a small wire that's only 100 lambda, 100 units long, it's not that big. Once we build up our fourth metal layer and we connect them, what happens is, even if we have some charge that causes a voltage in this long conductor that we've built, we have a diffusion here. The diffusion is basically a reverse biased diode, and the reverse biased diode can now have a reverse diode breakdown and dump this current down to ground. Okay, that's not the case on our right side here. Here we built up again metal layer one, and over here layer one, metal layer two, and layer two here. But we come up to metal layer three, we build these vias, and then we build this big conductor over here and this little conductor over here. And the thing is that a lot of charge built up inside this conductor. It was a lot of charge and it caused a large voltage over here. And this voltage was so large it had nowhere to go because this isn't made yet, right? We haven't, that's in our next process step. So in the meantime, we have this large voltage because of the charge that was built up here. And we have this little tiny gate. We said it can be like a couple nanometers thick. So what's gonna probably happen here is all this is just gonna, is just gonna discharge through the gate. And once it discharges through the gate, it's going to burn out the gate and ruin our circuit. So we can't allow that to happen. So basically what we're looking at is we have to look at the total amount of metal area that is not tied to a diffusion. So over here, that was the amount of metal that was not tied to a diffusion. Over here, it was this amount of metal that was not tied to a diffusion. And we have to divide that by the gate area. And this ratio has some sort of threshold, again, between 100 and 5,000. It depends on our manufacturing process on our technology node. But anyway, there's some threshold that's given, and we must make sure that we do not pass that ratio. Otherwise, there is a high probability that during manufacturing, we're going to burn out several gates and our circuit's not going to work. Okay, so again, what do we do? We look at the transistor over here. Here's the gate of the transistor. We look at the amount of metal that's connected to the transistor without to the gate of the transistor without being connected to a diffusion. Once we have a connection to a diffusion like here, then we have this diode that the current can break down through without ruining the circuit. So how do we fix this? And this is an important thing, and it's something that us as designers do. Well, the easiest way is just to make sure we have short wires. But how do we make sure we have short wires? Well, there are two actual ways to do this. Because we have to, due to our circuit, we might have long wires, right? But one way is what we call bridging. So over here, we have this diffusion over here, and over here, we have this gate, and we maybe had a wire that was connecting between it. All we have to do is make sure that in a short distance from our gate, we have what we call a bridge. We have to go up to a high metal before we connect to the rest of the metal. Once we do that, and we see that this connection, which connects this piece of the wire to this piece of wire, is higher than the connection over here, it means that once we got up to metal 1, 2, 3, we made metal 3, all of this was connected to this diffusion, and the charge that was built up here and maybe had a large voltage can now discharge through this diode that's over here. Okay. And that's before we actually make this metal 4 connection, which connects all this whole thing and is now connected to the gate over here. Actually, in this case, it would also be okay because we do have the diffusion over here. So what we're going to do is somewhere close to the gate, we're going to go and bridge up. And then whatever was collected in the charge over here is going to discharge previously through the diffusion over here. Okay, so that's the one way, again, is just by routing it a bit more carefully by making this little bridge. If we can't, for some reason, make such a bridge that will give us a smaller area, what we can do is we can actually put a diode like this. So here's a diode. We can put it a short distance away from our gate. If the diode's there, then once we have this long piece of metal, it will dissipate through the diode. The charge will dissipate through the diode instead of breaking our gate. So here you can see the diode, and we actually have a standard cell that will be called an antenna diode, and we can use it to make sure that if we have any antenna violation, we can just stick it next to our gate, whatever it is, and then it will protect the gate from antenna problems. So that's the second effect we want to talk about, antenna effect. The third effect I want to talk about is layer density. So we'll get a design rule from the fab that says that the layer density of metal layers, but actually any layer, has to be somewhere around between 30% and 70%. What that means is that the coverage of our whole area, let's say this is our chip, when we look and we add how much the area covered by all of metal one is, for example. Right, we have metal one that's all over the chip in different ways and shapes and sizes. We have to count it up. It can't be too much and it can't be too little. Now, why does that happen? Well, we'll look over here. We have this type of a drawing over here, and this is a drawing that is a high density area. Okay, so here we have the inner layer dielectric, and these are our metals. These are conductors, and we have a lot of conductors. It's a high density area. Then again, we have another area where all this, again, is our interlayer dielectric. We have a few wires that are running through. That's a low area density. When we do an etch, okay, what's going to happen is we're probably going to have a different type of etch here in the middle than we will in other places, okay? And when we do that, we'll probably get something like dishing. So maybe the interlayer dielectric, maybe this copper area is softer, so it will etch more, and then we'll have the height actually of the conductor here will be shorter than it should be, which is this height, and then we get higher resistance. So that's called dishing, okay? So what is our solution? We have a high density area over here. We have a low density area over here. When our DRC tool goes over it and sees that there's a low density area, it'll say, aha, listen, you have a density violation here. What you should do is you should put in a bunch of dummy metals over here, okay? And once we get these dummy metals over here that are just floating or connected to VDD and or ground, then actually it causes the density in this layer to be within our limits, okay? So those are dummy layers. We can't take them for granted because they do have some sort of coupling capacitance to our signals, and so they may affect timing. But in general, they're just these layer extra pieces of metal that we add after routing our design. So that's layer density. The last phenomena I want to talk about is what's called latchup. Okay, so we have these strange structures that we discussed before, that we have lots of P-type implantations and N-type implantations all across our channel. For example, in what we show here, we have an area where we have NMOSes, so we have two N plus diffusions, and we have a P plus diffusion, which helps us tap our substrate and bias it to ground. Okay, and then we have this N-well over here, and inside the N-well, we have P plus diffusions, which make our PMOS transistor, and we have an N plus diffusion, which lets us tap our N-well to VDD. And that we did purposely to keep these reverse bias diodes. But there's another thing that can happen. We can get these parasitic NPN transistors in all kinds of places. So in this specific situation where we just have a regular NMOS next to a regular PMOS, we get inherently this type of this NPN over here, which is connected, for example, between this source or drain, the P substrate, and the N-well. That makes an NPN transistor. And we have the P diffusion, the source or drain of this transistor, connected to the N-well over here and connected to the P substrate. So those are two types of NPN and PNP BJT transistors that we'll get. And if we make our scheme of this, what we can see is we get this type of a thyristor. Okay, what is a thyristor? Well, let's say for some reason there was some sort of noise, or maybe a particle that hit our substrate, or in some way there was some sort of ground bounce that made us get a large voltage over here. Okay, well, what this large voltage or any type of current that's going to cause a voltage. So if our voltage was over 0.5 or 0.7 volts or something like that, what it's going to do is going to turn on this BJT transistor, and we're going to start to get this current that's running down this side. If there's current running down here, that same current is going to be going down this resistor, and it's going to cause a voltage over here. That's going to turn on this PNP transistor, and it's going to start running voltage here, which is going to increase or at least maintain this voltage, which is going to keep this BJT on, keep increasing or maintaining that, which is keeping and increasing or maintaining this current, making this voltage rise, keeping this guy on, and therefore we're going to get this positive feedback that's going to cause, first of all, a rise in voltage or at least a maintaining voltage, and it's probably going to burn out our whole chip. That's called latchup. So you see there was a latchup of all the currents over here that keep growing in with this positive feedback. Okay, so how are we going to reduce the risk of latchup? Well, we're going to use well or substrate contacts. Why is that going to help? So this is caused because of these resistors. Okay, what are these resistors basically? They're just the resistance between wherever we tap our well or our substrate. So we actually connect ground right over here, and we connect VDD over here. But between here and some point, like say this point in our substrate, there is a finite resistance. It's not zero. Okay. And again, so that way we can have a voltage that's different than zero over here, because it's not exactly at the connection point. Same thing over here. We tapped our well over here. At some point along our N well, we're going to have a different voltage possibly, because there's a finite resistance between them. If we can keep that resistance as low as possible, then the voltage at each point in the substrate will be as close to our tapping voltage as possible. And the way to do that is by tapping in as many places as possible. Again, if we have this resistor really, really, really small, we need a lot of current to go through in order to cause a voltage that will turn this BJT on. If we keep this resistance small, we need a lot of current to get a voltage to build up here that will turn this BJT on. So our solution is put a lot of these well taps, these guys and these guys, all over the chip to make sure that the resistance between every two points on the substrate or the N well is as small as possible. So let's see how we do this tapping in our layout. They're called taps or bulk contacts. Okay, so what we have over here is we have a PMOS transistor on the left side and an NMOS transistor on the right side. Starting with the left side, to make a PMOS transistor, again, we make an N-well area, which is this part over here. We put some sort of poly over diffusion, and to make sure it's PMOS, we add a P-select or a PP, P-plus layer on top of it, and that tells our process to make a PMOS transistor over there. So what are we going to do in order to tap the N-type? Remember, what we have over here, again, is we have the N-well. Okay, this is N-well with our P-type transistor. So this is P-plus and P-plus, and that's going to be our transistor over there. What we want to do now here is we want to put an N-plus area and then connect it to VDD. Okay, so how are we going to do that? We're going to put an OD layer, a diffusion layer over here. So that's going to be this type of active type thing. Okay, we're going to mark it with an N-select or an N-plus area. So that means it's an N-plus type of diffusion. We're going to put a contact on it. So that's actually making this contact between a metal layer and the diffusion, and put a piece of metal that's going to be connected somewhere to our VDD voltage. Okay, same thing on the other side. So on the other side, we have our substrate. Again, we have N plus and N plus diffusion that's going to make our NMOS transistor, and this is P sub. So what we want to do here is we want to put a P-type diffusion, and that we want to connect to ground. Okay, so how are we going to do that? We're going to put our active layer, and on top of the active layer, we're going to put the P-select or P-plus layer to tell us that it's a P-plus type of a diffusion. Then we're going to put our contact on it, which is the contact here that touches between the substrate and the metal layer. And the metal layer is going to be connected to ground or VSS. Okay, so those are the manufacturing issues I wanted to discuss, and actually we finished our lecture on the manufacturing process for now. This is the detail that I'm going into in manufacturing process. These things are going to apply to us when we're designing our circuits. They're going to affect us. They're going to cause all kinds of phenomena that we're going to see in the following lectures. If you want a really good overview of a detailed overview with a lot more physics and a lot more math behind it, you can look at Jay Plummer's book, Silicon VLSI Technology. It's a really good book with an overview of this. And of course, there's a lot of stuff in Rabai's book. And Chenming Hu put out a wonderful book called Modern Semiconductor Devices for Integrated Circuits. He also actually discovered and invented a lot of this stuff. And Yossi Shacham, a friend of mine from Tel Aviv, he has a lot of good material, and he actually has a lot of the research that goes into these parts. So that's it for this lecture, and see you next time in Lecture 3, which is MOSFET modeling.